I am Ruwan Edirisinghe. By profession, I am an engineer, pass out from Peradeni, a product of free education of this country. And I pass out from Peradeni in 1994. And I started my business in 1996, after 2 years. At the moment, actually, I am the chairman and managing director of RN Group of Companies, which comprise of 6 companies: RN Constructions, which is one of the top level contract in Sri Lanka. And I have another 5 companies which are into manufacturing. We have 14 manufacturing units in all over the country. And I am working as the senior vice president of Federation of Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and senior vice president of senior vice chairman of National Chamber of National Chamber of Industries, and also committee member of COIL, Chamber of Young Lankan Entrepreneurs, and also I am a panel member of Sri Lanka Standard Institution, and also member of the Committee of Engineering Council of University Grants Commission. So all these we do because I got my education freely from the country, so I want to work back to the country using my time. So I am using 1.5 days per week for the national works, and also I am elected for as the senior vice president of SAARC Chamber of Commerce and Industry. I'll be the chairman in the SAARC Chamber of Commerce and Industry next year. So that's about a brief introduction about me. I started my business actually in 1996 with a capital of 500 rupees in my pocket, and I work as a laborer in a construction project to do the barbending work. That is where I started in 1996 with 3 laborers. I was sleeping in the Pollathumadu on rubber planks. That is where I started. Today my group is about 12 billion plus turnover company, having given employment to more than 3,000 people in the country. So how I came up to this level is by doing highly professional business enterprise. In my life, I have never bribed anybody a single cent. I have not gone behind any politician. I do my work using my engineering knowledge. If somebody can prove that I have paid a 1 rupee commission to anybody in this world, I will write off my all wealth to that person and work under him until I die. So I am so pure, we are doing that professional business. But only thing is, this country, it's very difficult for people like us to continue business. Most of my friends are asking, how the hell you are doing this business? Because everywhere corruption is coming. In addition to corruption, we are facing huge difficulties in financing our businesses, because politically biased people are using the national wealth and they are using for their benefit, and politicians are looking at that. And unfortunately, industrialists and all the poor people in this country is paying back that. I will come into those areas one by one. Coming to the main topic of your national trade policy in international business, and also bilateral agreements, or whatever the trade agreements, I will tell you the difficulties as an industrialist, and also representing more than 10,000 industrialists in the country. I am talking about on behalf of everybody, not only myself. But what I can see is, I will pick few points which are very seriously effective duty bilateral agreements that we have already signed with other countries which are very close to our country. Mr. Fernando knows that when he was in the Department of Commerce, we have worked with you. Now see the free trade agreement that we have signed with India. Now due to the very poor capacity of our national bureaucrats, the negotiators are very poor in making decisions for on behalf of the country. Sometimes I am not criticizing them, but only thing is, the government have to take steps to employ relevant people in negotiation in bilateral agreement, because those are not revocable. So unfortunately, most of the bilateral agreements are decided by 2 or 3 people in the country who are continuously there, and their ideas are taking up as the national ideas, but those are not as national ideas. They are not giving any opportunity for the industry, so the other national professionals in the country. Because of that, the repercussions are very serious. Now see, we have signed an agreement with India, bilateral agreement, in year 2000 or so. What are the things that we are exporting to India? The highest, the biggest item that we are exporting to India is Arecanut. We have an agreement with Pakistan, bilateral agreement. The biggest thing that we are exporting is bitter leaf. Are they our main products in our country? No. See, Indian bilateral agreement. Now they come back by showing with the political support that CEPA is going to sign to rectify all the damages or the weaknesses of the FTA, Free Trade Agreement of India. But CEPA came in a different way. With lot of efforts, we had to come down to the roads that to do the protest. Of course, we had enough experience in the university during that time, having that experience. Actually, I organized 2,000 employees of our Sri Lankan big companies within half an hour to come to the road and do a protest to, you know, stop Mr. Mahinda Rajapaksha to sign the CEPA in India under the pressure, with the UN Council pressure, right? We had to come down to the road. That was the only option at that time. Fortunately, he listened, right? But it is continuing. Now it is coming as ETCA. Now see, Sri Lanka is the biggest manufacturer of solid tires in the world. We are supplying more than 25% of the world requirement. Now see, according to the Free Trade Agreement with India, we cannot export any solid tires to India. Though we are supplying 25% of the world demand, we cannot supply. But we can supply pneumatic tires. Do you know why? There is only one tire manufacturer in the country, pneumatic tire, which was earlier Canadian Tire, now Seat. They are an Indian company, so they have given us. Now when it is tire, I don't know why the hell our bureaucrats at least to talk about at least to that, to see that we are exporting our products to India, because tires are exporting, but only pneumatic tires. Now we were given chance to export tea, which is one of our main products, to Cochin. Cochin is the biggest growing area of tea in India. Now when we supply to India, they take more than 3 weeks to do a testing for our tea supply to India. We have to take samples of our tea that we have exported from the Cochin port to Mysore, which is about, I think, 2000 kilometers, and they take more than 3 weeks. They actually purposely delaying approval. So by the time we get the approval, it's more than 4 weeks, and we have to pay demurrages. When we pay the demurrages, when things are going to the market of Cochin, it is much more expensive than what they have. So, but look at Maruti cars. India, if you see any city of India, Maruti cars are manufacturing in India. If you see any city of India, the concentration of Maruti cars is much more less than the concentration of Maruti cars in Sri Lanka. An unfortunate situation, the Maruti cars come into Sri Lanka by 12 hours or maximum 25 hours after clearing from the port, it is running on the road with a number. Now one professor from India who was having a big show in Taj Samudra Hotel, that is the day we decided to come to the road to protest. He was saying Sri Lanka is the younger brother, they are the elder brother, and they want to help Sri Lanka, and there is no advantage, and so forth. A professor was talking very big. I raised my hand and I asked him, can I have three questions from you? I asked these three questions. Then he said, yeah, I agree with you, brother. You all are very efficient. That is why our cars are coming to road within 12 hours. We are not efficient. That is why. I said, what the hell, we have the advantage. Now you just now told the Indian elder brother want to help the younger brother, and they don't have any advance. Who is having the, we don't have any advance with inefficient people like Indian guys. They are not to criticize India. But only thing is, this is how we have signed agreements in the country. If you take Free Trade Agreement with Pakistan, worse. Now, see, look at CEPA. It's much more worse. We don't have any policies, any national policies, any professional bodies placed in each and every profession to protect. We were going to open the whole national and free bodies movement through the country if it happened. Now all of us are maybe beggars, right? Because they will come. India is having more than 200 million graduates. You have seen one of the advertisement. One of the I think everybody knows that one of the local government in India have published advertisement for PN, 16 positions PNs. They got 348,000 applications. Out of that, 250 plus people were having a PhD, and more than 200,000 graduates. So we know what are their graduation. They will come here, doctors will come with a stethoscope and come with a small desk in front of the hospital, and they will give medicine for $50, 50 rupees, and lawyers will come for 50 rupees. So where are we going? So where the actually the agreements, we our request is, I don't know whether there is any advantage with the free trade agreement with any other country, because the agreements that we see, have, if you go back, the growth rate of our export is nothing comparing to the growth rate of our export to the other countries where we don't have a free trade agreement. So there is no advantage. Advantages are with them. And what will happen during using the free trade agreement will be, they will grab us, they will rule us in the future by economy. Earlier, we were ruled by, you know, Europeans or English people or somebody with political way. Now it will be, you know, economic control. So we don't want that. Having a very special, very, very unique location in geography in the world as a very free island, we don't have any landlocked problem. Now if you see Nepal, Nepal is surrounded by two nations. One side is China, three sides India. They cannot develop because they don't have any access to the ports. So they have to use Kolkata. That from Kolkata to Nepal is only more than 150 kilometers, that's all. But they take more than 2 weeks to deliver something because barricades are there. There is no way that in Nepal people, but we don't have that problem. So why we want to go behind these people? So coming back to the effect of free trade agreement, I am into steel building industry. I started steel building manufacturing in 2005 to 2007. I bought a small company which was running in the country. They were doing about 2% of local demand of steel buildings in Sri Lanka for industrial buildings, factories, warehouses like that. By the time we were importing building from Arabian countries and all over the world, from USA, about 70 to 75% of steel building demand in the country. But within 5 years, with our investment, and also there are another 42 manufacturers in the country, now Sri Lankans are manufacturing and supplying to 75% of the Sri Lankan demand, and now those huge, biggest companies in the world are supplying only 20%. Now, but the pre-trade agreement which we signed, now, there was a duty for steel. Now, at the moment also, raw material coming to Sri Lanka, we are paying for 15% to 45% up to that. Duties for each and every material coming to Sri Lanka. But unfortunately, as per the Indian agreement, free trade agreement, complete value-added steel building coming to Sri Lanka, 100% duty-free. Now, our raw material having a duty up to 40%, and building is coming to Sri Lanka duty-free. I don't know how we can, how industry can. Normally value added material should have a duty. Now people are actually, that is why I say the bureaucrats are sitting on their head and doing these things, right? And so we had to fight, 42 industrialists had to fight with the government. Fortunately, I became the best entrepreneur of this country in 2008. And I was selected as the best industrialist in Sri Lanka also 2008. So with that power, with that capacity, I went into these industrial chambers, and I took a lot of part of protection of the Sri Lankan industrialists, and I went up to the president of that of the country at that time. We were fighting for 3 consecutive years. All the government bureaucrats are coming with so many statistics, say not to that. I said, I asked the previous president, sir, just tell me one thing. Raw material in the country, we have to pay 15% to 40% duty. Finished product is coming duty free. So do you want Sri Lanka to depend on the other countries and pay them? Or do you want Sri Lankan industries? Tell us, because if you want that, we will close our business and we'll go and invest in another country, because they give enough opportunities to us. Then only everybody got together and they put a cess, because bilateral agreement, we cannot go back. So only a temporary cess. We had to come behind the government each and every year. Minister to minister policies are changing in our country. Unfortunately, I don't know, there is no country in the world The policies are changing by the minister to minister, to government to government. We don't have any national policy. So before going for any free trade agreement, we should have national policy in place, right? Now, after that, we place with lot of effort, we were able to protect the industry by keeping 25% cess. But recent government came, without talking to anybody, within one night, they removed it. Then I went and met the relevant minister 3 times, prime minister 3 times, president 2 times. I went, I will give you a copy of all these letters. I asked the same question. Within the last 5 years, my company alone, we have invested more than 6 billion rupees into manufacturing. We have the only fully automated steel building manufacturing plant in South Asia. We have the only fully automated sandwich panel manufacturing plant in South Asia. We have the only total range of scaffolding manufacturing plant in Sri Lanka. Now, we have invested like that, and there are another 42 companies have invested. We have invested in, on the other side of Hambantota Port, I have 5 factories, we have invested more than 1.2 billion rupees. But I have to run my industry using 700 kV generators. No road, nothing. We have to fight with elephants and do the work. Right? But we have to pay a huge amount of land cost and all that, but there is no, the port was not operating. Right? Government have agreed to give all the facilities by the port. Now see, I am sending more than 100 trailers every month from Colombo to Hambantota, from Hambantota. So our transportation cost is much more higher than our profit, because in the industry, the profit is maximum profit is 5%. So our country is not having any policy. I am very sorry to say, no policy. Politicians are coming to different locations and different ministries. They don't know in and out of it, and I don't know where they are getting advices. They are not giving any opportunity for the industrialists and the people who are dependent on that sector. Let's say if it is education, they have to study the thing with education related professionals and the other people and take decisions. Now it is not like that. They take inside a cabinet or whatever and they implement them. The effect to the industry today is very serious. Now see, central bank matter, everybody knows. Now earlier, our loans, what we took is AWPLR plus 1 to 2% or 3% somewhere there. So it was somewhere around 8% maximum. AWPLR was 6%. Today, AWPLR is more than 12%. Why? Everybody knows. Now who is going to pay that bridging of the additional interest of say 6%. So if a industrialist took a loan of 1 billion rupees, see, he has to pay 6% more. If the profit is 5%, if we are paying 13% interest, are you advising industrial to invest? Now, I have given 3,000 plus employment, and I'd like to see that employees are having a good life, so we have to maintain them, giving them good salary and all that. But instead, it is advisable for us to sell everything, maybe to China or somebody, and deposit this money in the bank, because bank interest rate is 12%. So why we are wasting our time to do industry in this country and to get a lesser profit, right? So national policies have to place in place very especially by the politicians. Of course, my friend Mr. Jayasekhar, now you know how much we are fighting for this. I think first thing, before going into any trade agreement, we have to first lay national policies for each and every sector. And we have to protect our professional bodies perfectly by keeping law and order. Then only we can talk about free trade agreements. But I have a question. With the experience that we have with the free trade agreement so far we have gone through, what are the advantages we have? What we see is decline of our market. With having a free trade agreement, we don't have any gain. So better not to have. And I like to talk about little bit about the Chinese free trade agreement also. Now, if the yeah, okay. So okay. Can you give me 1 minute? Okay. So bottom line, I am representing more than 10,000 industrialists. So please take this very seriously. Our request for you is to propose the governments to have a national policy for at least for next 15 years, number one. each and every trade, each and every profession, we need to have a national policy. It can be a blue-colour government, brown-colour government, or different colour government, the same policy should be there. Yeah, because now blue and green is not there, now different colours. So we want that to place. And before going for any free trade agreement, give a chance to all stakeholders, very especially the chambers, the professional bodies, and discuss that one by opening the actual situation. Of course, no one knows. Now we are talking about SEPA, we are talking about ETCA, everything, but no one knows exact area. Now sometimes they are asking, how the hell do you know? We know, we have ways and means of taking them, you know, indirectly, but we don't know exactly. So that has to be opened up to some extent. We know you can't open everything. So after that only, you have to decide whether you are going for a free trade agreement. So thank you very much for giving this time.